Hi again. Welcome to tutorial 4 of the Reinforcement Learning Day of Neuromatch Academy 2020. My name is Marcelo Matar, and in this tutorial, I'm going to tell you about model-based reinforcement learning. Now, this is one of my favorite topics ever, as I think it's a great framework for understanding a variety of fascinating topics in neuroscience and cognitive science, such as planning, memory replay, memory consolidation, and even dreaming. So for this reason, this is actually the topic that I study in my own lab. So here's the high-level idea. So far, we've seen how agents learn to act by acting in the world. So it's like trial and error. They act, they experience the outcome of their actions, and then they learn from those outcomes. So these models are called model-free because they do not require a model. And in fact, that's the case for both Q-learning and SARSA algorithms that we just learned in the previous tutorial. Now, in this tutorial, we will learn about model-based methods, which compute actions via a process called planning. This means that instead of computing values from experience, planning will allow the agent to compute actions from a model. Well, wait a second. What is a model? A model is a representation of how the world might respond to the agent's actions. In some way, you can think of a model as a representation of the environment that lives inside the agent. So formally, you define a model as a mathematical object such that given a state and an action, it outputs a prediction of the resulting state and reward. So just like an environment works, except that it's inside the agent. And the advantage of having a model is that you can use it to mimic or simulate real experience. But if you can simulate experience, you can then learn from those simulations. So think about it this way. In model-free reinforcement learning, the agent uses real experience to compute values and ultimately a policy via a process called learning. So this is just like we've seen in all previous tutorials. In model-based reinforcement learning, however, the agent instead uses simulated experience, which is produced from a model, to compute those values. And the process of computing values and ultimately a policy from simulated experience is what we call planning. But it turns out that planning and learning are not necessarily mutually exclusive. It's fairly easy to program an agent that can implement both things concurrently. And this diagram actually illustrates exactly that. If we focus on the right inner loop here, we see that the agent has a value function indicating the values of different actions. And using those values, the agent can then select and execute an action, producing real experience. And then this real experience can be used in two ways. First, it can be used in the usual way, using model-free learning algorithms, such as Q-learning and SARSA, to teach the animal or the agent about action values. But the agent can also use real experience in a different way. For instance, the agent can learn about how the world works, how it evolves, how it responds to each action, and so on. In other words, the agent can learn a model. And with a model available, the agent can then use planning to produce its own simulated experiences and then to learn from them. So this is the idea, and in fact, a very powerful one, that underlies a variety of cutting-edge reinforcement learning algorithms, including those that Google DeepMind used to beat professional players in the board game Go. Now, unfortunately, we're not going to implement DeepMind's algorithms for playing Go today, but we will nonetheless implement a model-based reinforcement learning algorithm called Dyna-Q to illustrate the concepts that I just described. So Dyna-Q is possibly the simplest reinforcement model-based reinforcement learning algorithms, which integrates learning and planning. In the exercise that you're going to do next, we will analyze Dyna-Q in detail, but just to give you an idea, in a nutshell, this algorithm will implement Q-learning in steps A through D. As you can see here in this table, the agent observes the state, chooses an action, takes the action and observes the result, and then learns from the outcome in step D. Then in step E, the agent learns the model, simply saves and remembers what was the result of the action that it executed. And then in step F, it implements planning. It loops N times, selecting a state and an action to simulate, remembering what were the results by drawing the result from the model and then learning that in the very last line of this algorithm. Now, what's the relevance of this for neuroscience? Well, for one, I'm sure we would all agree that our brains are sometimes focused on things other than what's happening around us. For example, we may remember things that have happened in the past, or we may think about things that might happen in the future. And of course, this is not an accident of evolution. It's really not difficult for us to see why it might be useful for us to learn from imagined or remembered experiences in addition to real experiences. But we don't have to rely only on our phenomenological experiences to study this ability. So it turns out that in the last couple decades, we've been able to record neuroactivity that relates precisely to this phenomenon. This is called hippocampal replay, and I find it a fascinating type of data. So let me show you an example. In this beautiful paper here by G. N. Wilson, the authors recorded activity from both the visual cortex and the hippocampus of the animal as it explored an environment. They observed some patterns that you can see in the top line. And then during sleep, they observed that in both regions, both in the hippocampus and in the visual cortex, there were brief moments in time when the neuroactivity resembled what had happened during awake behavior, with the caveat that those sequences were a bit compressed in time. But they really looked a lot like what had been observed during awake behavior. So the hypothesis that they were testing and found supporting evidence for is that perhaps the hippocampus is engaged in model-based planning, simulating experiences from the past, and then the cortex is learning from those replayed experiences that the hippocampus is producing. This, in fact, is a long-standing idea about how the brain consolidates memories in a process called systems consolidation. But a similar phenomenon can actually happen also during awake behavior. Turns out that if you record from place cells in the hippocampus as the animal navigates, while, you know, most of the times you're seeing the cells firing according to the actual location of the animal, this is just how place cells work. Sometimes if the animal stops, for instance, if it arrives at some bifurcation in a maze, you find that place cells are not representing the actual location of the animal, but instead they can represent future locations, just like if the animal was remembering or imagining what might happen next. This is known as awake replay and is thought to be the neurobasis of planning. Now, it turns out that the story is a bit more complicated. The sequences not only go forward, sometimes they can also span in, backwards behind the animal, and sometimes they can represent remote locations altogether. So it's difficult to imagine how all of this is serving the role of planning. But if you want to see how reinforcement learning as a mathematical language can be used to explain all of these findings, and in fact, to link various ideas from memory retrieval to planning, consolidation, and even dreaming, I suggest that you take a look at this 2018 paper by Nathaniel Daw and myself. All right, I'm gonna stop here for now, and I'll let you play with the code implementing Dyna-Q. Have fun implementing your first model-based reinforcement learning agent.